I've had this Traxxas T-MAXX 3.3 for almost 10 years now. Thing still runs great, believe it or not. The body, though, is starting to show its age. It looks like shit, and it's falling apart. The back is split in two, and it needs to be replaced. You can get a new one, but they're like 40 bucks, and it's the same flimsy plastic as the original. I get why they're made that way. They're cheap, light, they take the impacts, they fall apart, you get a new one, rinse, repeat. But I thought, can I make a better one? And if so, could I 3D print it? Well, it was a lot more effort than I bargained for, but the answer is yes. So keep watching to find out how to make the ultimate 3D printed, CNC machined, carbon fiber laminated RC body and roll cage. The first step is to 3D scan the existing body. I used an app called ScandyPro that works impressively well. I put the existing body on a Lazy Susan, rotated it in front of the phone, and ended up with this scan. Pretty legit for $6 a month. I exported the scan as an STL and brought it into Fusion 360. Although the scan quality is good, it's nowhere near good enough to directly print, and still not good enough to make surfaces out of or any sort of direct modeling like that. So I used the scan just as a guide to model up my own body. This was a crazy complex model that took a ton of time to make, so I won't cover all the details in this video, maybe a future video, but the short version starts with some simple 2D extrudes to get a rough base shape. I then used a combination of sketches and CAD wizardry to slice and dice into the final shape using the scan data as a guide. I added strengthening features like these ribs in the back and in the front where I know there's going to be a lot of impacts, an air scoop to feed the engine cooling and intake air, and since this body is about 20 inches long by 8 inches wide by 6 inches high, it has to be split up into three bodies to fit on my printer and print without a ridiculous amount of support. Now since it's split up into three bodies, that creates a huge weak point at each of the seams. To help counter that, there's a series of screws and dowel pins to hold everything together and help the three bodies line up. Finally, since each of these bodies is going to be printed like this, there's going to be a huge weak point in all forces in this direction. So to counter that, and perhaps the coolest part of the design, are two aluminum braces that go over the top, bolt all three bodies together, and take the brunt of any impacts. To further accentuate the importance of the braces, check out this FEA simulation from an impact on the top of the body, say from a hard upside down landing. Huge forces and resultant stresses right through the body joints and along the Z-axis of the printed parts. Not good. Now check out the same simulation with the braces. You can't even see the deformation, and almost all of the stresses are constrained to the braces instead of the body. Impacts from the sides will impart mostly XY stresses into the body, which the printed parts will be able to handle as long as we use the right material. So, the combination of a printed body strong in the XY plane and aluminum braces to take any Z loads should lead to a very robust final design. Now's a good time to note that you could totally print these braces lying flat and get similar results. The aluminum is just much tougher and, well, leads to a cooler video. Before printing, we have to choose a material. In my opinion, the obvious choice for a high-impact application like this is nylon. My initial thought was unfilled nylon for flexibility and impact strength. I really like Polymaker filaments, and as I was looking at their datasheets, I saw their carbon fiber nylon has much more impact strength than the unfilled. They are one of the few manufacturers to publish as-printed Z mechanical properties, and they claim this stuff has improved mechanical properties in the Z compared to unfilled nylon. They also claim it is warp-free, which is important printing a thin-walled part this big on an open printer. It's not cheap, but you could get 2 kilograms for $110 on Black Friday, so not terrible. I went for it. I printed a couple prototypes out of PLA to test fit and printability, as well as a few test parts out of the nylon to see how it prints. The PLA parts let me dial in the dimensions, and the nylon prints showed that even at 300C, overhangs were printable to 65 degrees, but stringing and oozing were major issues. Slicing was a project in and of itself, and like the design, won't be covered in detail in this video, but the primary goals were to avoid travel moves and supports on the outsides of the part so there wasn't any stringing or blobs on the cosmetic side, as well as keeping the wall line count at 2 and only 2 as much as possible. Spots like this, where the printer has to add an extra internal wall, lead to cosmetic and functional defects. This? Good. No extra yellow lines in there. This? Bad. Lots of green and yellow lines. I controlled this by modifying the line width in Cura. I found that a 0.74 millimeter wall with a 0.6 millimeter nozzle tended to work best. Finally, time to start making parts. I'm using a CR10 V3 modified with a volcano hot end so I can fully melt composites with a hardened nozzle, and a PT1000 so I can print long term at 300C. Hopefully I'll make a video on this upgrade someday. It took about 30 hours and half a kilogram of material to print all three parts. These were all printed at a toasty 300C without an enclosure. I annealed each part in the oven after printing.
The printed parts look phenomenal. I'm really excited to put everything together. The front piece, the outside, looks amazing. The inside is not quite as amazing. There's quite a bit of stringing and goobering in there, but since this is a U-shaped piece, you're able to keep all of the travel moves, or most of the travel moves, restricted to the inside, which keeps the outside surface pretty string and goober free. Middle piece, same story. This is also U-shaped, so you're able to keep all the imperfections on the inside, and we were able to sand away most of those imperfections here as well. Outside surface looks great. Backside, this is the most complicated piece, so it's not as easy. Well, it's actually impossible to keep all the travel moves restricted to the inside, and you do end up with some imperfections back here, but I was able to sand most of those away. I did experiment using combing mode in Cura, which keeps the nozzle above printed pieces only, so you kind of avoid stringing. But since these were thin-walled parts, it led to a lot of excessive buildup, unnecessary excessive buildup along the printed profile, which caused globs and other imperfections on the surface much more frequently, and they weren't restricted to one side. So this was the lesser of two evils and easy to sand away.
Time for the aluminum brace cam. I got excited at the metal store when I found a piece of 6x36x5/8 6061 in the bargain bin and bought it without thinking enough about how these parts actually fit in that. Turns out they barely fit in a way that my router can handle, so I'm machining at a 45 and have to knock off the corners to get the stock to fit. Very far from ideal. First, I chopped off the corners with a miter saw. Pretty surprising how easily that went through the aluminum. Setting this up in the router was a huge pain in the ass. I used mating dowel pinholes in the spoil board and stock to locate everything. I intended to add some tapped holes in the spoil board and hold everything down with bolts instead of clamps, but the angle got me all confused and I ended up tapping the pinholes and reaming the tapped holes. I fixed it, but it caused some problems later on. After learning that lesson on angles, it was off to the races machining. If you've seen my previous video, you know this amount of material is a piece of cake compared to the 18 pounds I was doing before. On the front side, everything went really well. As with the design and slicing, I won't go too deep into the cam, but maybe on a part 2 video sometime in the future. The second side was also going great until I cut the profile out. I don't know why I thought 2 number 8 bolts would be enough to hold these down with all that material removed. They ended up moving all over and I made some mistakes, but otherwise they still turned out nice.
The machine parts also look phenomenal. From 2 feet away, they look damn near perfect. Up close, there's a few issues. I wasn't able to get things aligned perfectly when I flipped it over machining, but otherwise, everything is looking really nice, and functionally, it's gonna be perfect. In hindsight, I should have omitted all the 3D profiling I did. So for right here, for example, I should have just put a 2D profile, a 2D flat along the printed part so that this could mate to it. It would be a lot easier to print a flat on a contoured surface than it is to machine a contour on a flat surface, if that makes sense.
As if the carbon fiber nylon and machined aluminum wasn't enough, I decided to use carbon fiber and epoxy to reinforce the 3 seams between printed parts. You may be thinking, wouldn't Kevlar be better than carbon fiber for impact? You're thinking the same thing I am, but I'm not necessarily reinforcing for impact here. Laminating the whole thing with Kevlar would be badass, but since this was my first composite endeavor, I just want to reinforce the seams, which I don't want to bend or give at all and create a crack in the nylon or epoxy. Hence, carbon and its rigidity is the better choice here. While I was at it, I coated the entire body in epoxy and sanded it down before applying a top coat of epoxy, just to make everything smooth, shiny, and fill in any imperfections in the printed parts. Back to Kevlar versus carbon though. Let's talk about strength versus toughness, because I think this is something people often get confused with. This is a stress drain curve that Mark Forge, the 3D printer company, made for continuous carbon fiber, continuous fiberglass, and continuous Kevlar reinforced nylon, fairly similar to what we're doing here. It also has chopped carbon fiber nylon, onyx, and aluminum on there for reference. The y-axis is stress, similar to force. The x-axis is strain, similar to distance. Basically showing how much something moves for a given load. The higher the line goes, the stronger the material is. So carbon fiber here is really strong. It goes way up and it's stiff. It doesn't move much when a load is applied to it. But it's brittle. The line goes straight up until it breaks. No give. Kevlar, on the other hand, has a much less steep line that goes almost flat for a while, meaning that it's much more flexible and also starts deforming and absorbing energy before it breaks. That's why bulletproof vests are made of Kevlar. If you take the area under these curves, you essentially get force times distance, which is energy or toughness. Kevlar is much tougher than carbon. But an important thing to note here is that the flat part of the line is plastically deforming, so it's permanently damaging the material. According to this graph, if you wanted the most impact strength without permanent damage, you should really use fiberglass. So, on paper, if you wanted to make this body as tough as possible, you'd want to laminate the entire thing in Kevlar or fiberglass. Just remember, glass is strong, rubber is tough, and generally metals give you the best combination of the two. Alright, back to the project. The last step was to add holes to the aluminum braces and attach them to the body. I just transferred the holes manually and sanded the body and brace down where necessary. I originally wanted to print a jig and use drill bushings to get the holes drilled perfectly, but the questionable fit after all the epoxy made me rethink it. The manual method ended up working just fine. There you have it. One ultra tough, 3D printed, CNC machined, carbon fiber laminated, RC car body. Say that three times fast. Let's just appreciate how cool this thing looks for a few seconds. Here's a shot of the carbon fiber on those inside seams. Imagine that on the whole thing.
I wish I could end this video by driving and testing this thing, but unfortunately I live in Minnesota and it's negative 10 and snowing out right now. So I can't drive it, but I can tell this thing's gonna be damn near indestructible. It's a culmination of a lot of work and I'm super happy with the way it turned out. I do have the CAD files posted in the description if you feel daring enough to take this on yourself or if you just wanna see the design in more detail. I would do a few things differently though, and I'd like to go into more detail on that, plus the design, printing, machining, and carbon fiber layup in a future video. So please like or let me know in the comments if you'd like to see a part 2, 3, 4. As a final plug, I also have a Jado 3.3 that also has a 3D printed roll cage. This one was a lot simpler and is a day-long project instead of a month. Subscribe to see that video as soon as it comes out.